Hiya.
I'm only a drummer, I don't normally get this shit.
Thanks. How's everyone?
Can we speak to you on the camera?
Is there anything I should be worried about?
Do you know what? I got a really bad rash from that costume.
It might be a bit medieval if I do my full name.
Joseph John Donovan.
Charles Anthony Salt.
Joe for short.
I'm Miles and I play keyboard. Is that how you say it?
I'm Josh Dewhurst.
Tom Ogden.
My name's Miles and I play the keyboards in Blossoms.
Drummer.
Bass guitar, backing vocals. And I play the lead guitar in Blossoms.
I'm gonna say it, I've never said it before, singer, songwriter in Blossoms. Cut.
Me and Joe became friends on a school trip to Alton Towers. Not very rock and roll, but we got to go on the trip for having 100% attendance. So that's how it all started.
Weirdly enough, I knew everyone before we was in the band, and obviously I knew Tom from school.
What are your names? Where are you from?
Just from like Scotport around the area.
And what are your names?
Oh, Joe.
Eva.
Tom.
Basically, I was in a band with Joe, and we all kind of knew each other from knocking around in Stockport. Tom was in another band called Save the Master Sound.
Then Tom put Josh's old band on a bill with him once.
We used to just do like Arctic Monkeys covers and Strokes covers and stuff like that.
They did this Arctic Monkeys cover and he absolutely nailed like the sounds of it. So we were like, we need to get Josh in.
I got a Facebook message from Joe.
I think I said to him, dead cringy, like, we should jam the 12-bar blues sometime. Which makes you feel sick saying it.
Still to this day, Blossoms is obviously 12-bar blues.
I was thinking, Christ, this is quite a big opportunity, you know? Especially when you're a kid as well and you've got these older guys who you look up to and they're saying, come and hang out with us and make some music.
We started jamming in the scaffolding yard.
Charlie had this room where we could just leave the gear. It was free and we could just go to, like, whatever time we wanted. It was mint, so I was like, right, you know what I mean, we can do something here. Got offered a gig at Night and Day. I think we got 36 people in. And at that time, like, even though you didn't get paid, if you got more than 30 people in, you got £1 per person who came in, so we got 36 quid. But Charlie parked the van outside Night and Day and got a £35 ticket fine. So started off with a quid profit, which is good.
The August of that year, Miles joined.
I moved into a flat above a curry house in Stockport, and we used to have like loads of parties there.
Which I was excluded from because I don't do fun.
Tom and Joe came to one of the parties once and they were looking for a keyboard player.
Miles had overheard Tom saying, yeah, we're looking for some like keyboard parts to pad out the band's sound.
And he was like, I can play keys, and he held up his hand with like a cast on it because he broke his wrist.
I'll play the keys. I can play the keyboards.
Couldn't play keyboards.
After running away from the police from pissing up a wall in Manchester.
In that kind of moment where they were like, we're looking for a keyboard player, I just jumped straight on it. I think the first song that we all kind of contributed to, which we still play now, is Blow. And I started playing this keyboard part and it basically ripped off the Doors. I remember afterwards they were like, that's fucking mint, that's what we need. And I was like, yeah, mint. And I peaked there.
He learnt the tunes in like an afternoon with Tom. But I think then we sort of like concreted the Blossom sound with Miles as the fifth member, do you know what I mean? Literally from there we knew that it was a lot different.
Automatically, I don't know, it was weird, something just clicked.
Ladies and gentlemen, Blossoms!
I think we always had our own identity from a really early point. Because we'd all been in other bands before Blossoms, we knew we wanted to do things differently. Like, we was like, right, we're gonna do our own gigs, we're gonna put it up and we're gonna create like a bit of mystery around the band and all wore the same thing and made the videos.
Your mystic lips, tell me this, throw me another lead, cause I can't tell, but under a spell in your eyes, they promise, show me what you want.
We did do a lot of gigs to like no one and it never felt disheartening with Blossoms. It just spurred us on to want to do more.
And that's exactly what they did.
Is anyone here from Stockport?
Taking their name from a local pub, the lads embarked on a relentless touring schedule. Blossoms went from playing to a few family and friends, topping the UK charts with their self-titled debut album. From there, their career went from strength to strength, supporting their boyhood heroes and playing on the pyramid stage at Glastonbury. They created their own brand of synth guitar pop. Non-stop writing combined with their infectious personalities earned them fans all over the world. From Woodsmore to Washington, Stepping Hill to Shanghai, they put their beloved hometown on the map. Now, with over 100 million plays on Spotify and two chart-topping albums, Blossoms are coming back to Stockport for their biggest gig yet. All with the aim of giving something back to the town they adore.
Where are we today?
XS Manchester for the new breakfast shop.
Very nice.
So you want some local lads.
Nice building.
Not allowed up here, mate. Band only.
It's a fucking massive telly, that, isn't it? Jesus Christ.
Right, Blossoms are here. I'm very excited because first week on the brand new breakfast show in XS Manchester. And you boys are here, which I'm buzzing about. Nice,
nice one.
Yeah, good
nice
morning.
Right, do you know what? I want to talk about, first and foremost, the biggest thing going on for you guys at the minute. It's massive. I'm sure not want to say. Tristan was the Spice Girls. What's going on?
Well, five become one. My girlfriend turned 30, so we had a big fancy dress party at our house.
My sister's 30th.
Tom's going out with my sister, so it's Tom's girlfriend, so whatever you prefer.
That.
So we're putting a gazebo up.
He's asking.
Chaz has a history with construction, doesn't he?
So. Get all the pieces out, get all the bars out, and set them in sections at each one.
On here.
Yeah, yeah.
Taking charge of each other.
Yeah. These fingers are insured for millions, you know, so don't want to break anything.
Right, so we need eight number twos.
Josh, yeah. How many musicians does it take to put a gazebo up? Four musicians, a sibling and two dogs.
Obviously, couples sometimes go as fancy dressed together, so then we were like, why don't we go one step further and do...
It was originally the Beatles, though, wasn't it?
Yeah, we said we were going to do the Beatles.
But it was only four.
Yeah.
Yep, got it. This one's a bit troublesome.
You might need to sand it with a stone.
File it down a bit of a...
I think it needs further filing. I need a more abrasive piece.
What's this one knocking off it?
Ray Mears says when building a gazebo in the wild that you've got to improvise and use what you have around you.
Next we see Joe make a fire with his bare hands. And then we cook the dog.
Whoa, man.
Nah, I could never do that. Oh, look, he's looking up now. Sorry, George.
Like what?
We'd never cook you, mate.
The instructions would have said, put the canopy on. That's what I thought.
Well, it was Tom that said you shouldn't put it on.
Whoa! Whoa! That was very tight. I know.
Zeebo,
I don't ask people who's complete.
I hate fancy dress.
Yeah, I'm into it.
But then when I'm there and I'm doing it, I love it.
This is what I wanted to talk about.
Pieced it out quite easy. Who would be who?
How did that conversation go down?
Well, Miles is blonde hair, so Baby Spice. Hey! Charlie. Scary Spice.
I look more like my mum than Scary Spice. That's scary
Spice. I'm tall, long legs, so we thought Victoria Beckham, Posh Spice. Then it was between Josh and Joe for either sporty and
I don't
Jerry.
Have a sporty figure because I'm, you know, severely malnourished. So, then
like... so then Joe was sporty and then that made the lineup. Then Josh was Jerry.
Who doesn't love dressing up as a girl, like, especially with legs like mine? You can go on Instagram and look, they're very, very, very hairy.
Good luck for all the gigs you've got coming up, especially Adgy Park, which is going to be amazing.
Yeah, nice one, man. Good luck to you as well.
Can't wait.
Cheers, boys.
See you later.
Mate. Cheers.
Are you
all
right?
A lot of
beers
going on.
Yeah, yeah.
Won't be around forever, will I? Fucking hell, man. 16 this year.
Standing,
Bletchley Park, I went once when I was about 10 or something, and that was the first kind of football stadium I went to. I think we were watching Stockport County versus obviously someone, and I think when the other team scored, I stood up and went, yes, County. And it was just, it wasn't even them. I was getting some funny looks, so I've not been back since. It's weird because it's 15,000 people. It's a lot of people, but in my head, I was being a bit blasé about it. And then when I went the other day, like I saw how big it was, and it's still a football fucking stadium, innit? I never get nervous for gigs, really, and I'm really, really nervous for this gig, so I don't know whether it's the whole occasion and the fact it's been on, it's been sold out for months. If I went to sell last week, we wouldn't be as nervous, but it's because it's been such a run-up to it kind of thing. And usually when you do other big gigs, you turn up on the day, don't you? You're just there and it's everything's presented to you within a couple of hours. But, like, these added thoughts, whether it's guest list, where everyone's sitting, making sure everyone's all right, like... You don't have that when you're playing in Moscow.
Yeah, that is it in the middle?
I'm not looking at it from
here. It's because you're looking at it from an angle, isn't it?
Be honest, Chaz used to drive for Home Run Pizzas. They were over there. And I used to work for Fair Price Funerals.
Looking at that, how does that make you feel then, hometown?
Making it more
shitting
reasonable.
Myself.
Fine. It's doing the opposite for me. I've been nervous this week, but seeing that, it's like, I'd be fine. Do you know what I mean?
You don't feel like it's for us. It's weird, isn't it?
Big though, isn't it?
This is the first time we've done anything of this size, so it's that stepping it into the stadium and the that level of band.
It means don't fly, you know. Bought a window seat so I can take a picture from the air. Foot's on the wrong fucking side of the plane.
It's definitely what we've been building up to since we started the band.
It's something we joked about doing years ago, you know, saying, oh, I imagine putting a gig on it. County.
We were like, I imagine playing Edgeley Park. We should be the first person to put a gig on.
It'd be amazing. There's never been a gig there. We've always said it, so to actually do it.
It's like a weird dream.
Yeah. You do big gigs, don't you? You do big gigs all the time. That's what you always want to do as a band. But I think to do a big gig in your hometown where, like, everyone seems to be coming together, and even with Stockport County getting promoted, it's, I don't know, it just feels like a bit more than a gig, do you know what I mean? I don't think we'll ever be able to recreate something like it again. What's up, Chaz?
There,
what's up, mate?
Get up there and see what needs fixing up. Used to be a scaff, mate.
I was having a proper heart-to-heart as well, then.
Rap shit. Hammer. Level.
Check it's level.
Are we?
Do it on the floor, son. Check the floor first, Chaz.
Yeah, let's get on the spray and spaghetti, this.
Bang
bad
on,
that,
Matt.
Yeah,
not
bad that.
Fair play.
Fun day.
All coming together, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
In terms of milestones, where we're up to, it's I'd say it's the most special thing.
The Legends Lounge.
You can play a gig anywhere. Like, do you know what I mean? We played the Pyramid Stage.
You know, we've done the Gorillaz, we've done the Academies, and then the Apollo. And
we've supported bands at the Etihad and Wembley. But they're not our fans. This is just our fans, like.
There's something different when it's your own headline, somewhere where you've lived so close to. It means so much more.
Charlie still comes down, he still comes to County again. That's why this gig's important. Because they've come back.
It's definitely a celebration of both the town and the band.
Let's stop port, lads, this is massive.
Yeah, they're giving something back, aren't they?
I can't remember the last time 15,000 people were in Edgeley, do you know what I mean?
People aren't used to seeing big gigs in Stockport, are they?
Love the Bossing!
This is a fucking great band.
It says a lot about people in Stockport and that sort of loyalty that people have towards us.
Seeing them go from, like, being dead small to playing the hometown doing Edgeley Park, sick.
People all over the world are flying over, do you know what I mean, to sort of watch us. And it blows my head, do you know what I mean? Like, I can't believe that people are flying back.
I'm from Australia.
but I knew of the Blossoms before I even came to Stockport.
Is she from Stockport?
Yeah, I am from Stockport, thank you.
It's a great thing for the town.
I feel proud for us and for Stockport because nobody talks about Stockport like we do.
Best place in the world, mate.
I'd like to think that we've done something for where we're from.
We didn't want to, like, class ourselves with all the other bands that are from the surrounding areas and say, oh, we're from Manchester. Like Tom always says, when he gets a letter through his letterbox, it says Stockport on it. Why say anything else?
I think Tom just said it at a gig. I think he was just like...
Good evening, Stockport. We are Blossoms from Stockport.
It just stuck after that.
The song's got honey sweet, everyone.
It's just a typical northern working-class town.
We've got a hat museum. We'd like to say we've got Europe's largest brick structure. I'm not entirely sure how true that is anymore. We've got a glass pyramid.
It's got the big cinema now. It used to have another cinema. This one's better.
It's a good vibe in Stockport.
I always feel like it's sort of the black sheep in a certain way. It's a big town, but it's not quite a city. And it's kind of overshadowed by Manchester a lot. So I feel like it's always left out.
Why don't you go to John's Cafe on the market?
I think if it wasn't close to Manchester, it'd be a bit kind of secluded. But it depends how old you are. Growing up, I never like craved anything from elsewhere.
It's just home, isn't it? I don't know, there's something about it, it's just cosy. And it's just dead easy, do you know what I mean? Like, why would I buy a house in London and live in like a thimble?
People are nice. Everyone's hardworking. The life revolves around football, music, and drinking.
Everyone's up for a good chat. Like, there's a few pubs in the around Stockport, you're like, oh, I won't go in there. But then when you do go in there, you always have, like, a good laugh, do you know what I mean?
People will take the piss out of you, but in a very endearing way, especially if you've got long hair and you're a bloke.
The town's kind of got behind us as a band, which I suppose shows what it's like as a town.
Yeah, I've spent a lot of good times and happy times in Stockport. I think there's something in the water, and it's made... Plus five, what we have today. Okay, I'm going to show you how to reload film onto the 1976 Pentax 6x7 camera. I was quite into football when I was a kid, so it was just out till all hours, you know what I mean? You don't really find that anymore, do you? I've been told I was very, very affable, quite approachable, fairly easygoing, quite creative, always pristine, never used to get muddy.
There's only stories of me being a bit strange as a kid. One of my earliest memories is me and my brother fighting in a skip outside our house. You know, usually, like, it's the older brother picking on the younger brother. It was the other way around with me. But it's fine, you know, we're friends now. Pretty quiet, I'd say. Kept myself to myself. Football crazy. That was kind of like the centre of everything.
I reckon I was a bit of a nerd, you know. I was like a counsellor at school and that. Got voted the nicest school kid in my year. I don't know why. I don't know who voted, actually.
Quite a peculiar child, which I don't think has changed. That went through to my first ever job, which was being a professional clown, which is real, but that happened. I was clowning for a good while.
For some reason, I got into this, like, circus realm. But it was far less sketchy than, like, running away to a circus. It was just this place where you'd go and learn to juggle. It seems really, really odd when I look back at it now. Now I'm sat here, like, a grown-ass man, you know. Like, yeah, strange times. But yeah, I rode to Joe's house on a unicycle. It's pushing a mile, I reckon, that. So I'm quite proud of that one. I had to hang up the nose and the oversized shoes. I think I knew that clowning was over for me.
Thank you very much, Evan. Is anyone in love in the audience tonight at Stockport? This is for anyone in love. If there's a few of you. My eyes align with you. You're on my side, and I'm all truth. She said, I never lie. You are rare, and I care. Yes, I should show it more sometimes. Some words won't hurt. A metaphor or five. Now I'll be gone for weeks, but forgetting to tell you. You're just a flight away. You give me that love talk. Only made me feel worse. I hate leaving the town that owns me. Tonight you're mine. Will be love talk, love talk. I'm sat in your car. I play some big star. 10 years came pretty soon. Then you whisper, I will miss you. Only you can change my mood. You look at me and you say, why can't they go without you? You're just a flight away. You give me that love talk. Only made me feel worse. I hate leaving the town that owns me. Tonight your mind will be love talk, love talk. Thank you. How are we feeling, Stockport? We're feeling good. It's nice to see so many of you come out. It's good. Funny story. Last time me and Joe were here, 10 years ago to this month, we had our prom in that building over there. In our little suits. And a fucking limo. 10 years later, and we're stood in front of you beautiful people, so there we go.
For this gig, obviously the big gig, I was like, should go into the tailors and we'll flesh out a few ideas with them and just sort of get some stuff made.
So this is where I used to work
last few days been working on the set, and then today working what we're going to look like.
You have to use your imagination, don't you?
How are you doing?
Good,
thanks. Nice to see you. How's things? Good.
Good. Really good.
What did you used to do when you worked?
My first job when I came in, fogged booth like that, I used to have to hoover the mat at the front and sweep down all these.
What was Joe like when you used to work with him?
Brilliant. Yeah, he was amazing.
It was like a proper apprentice. I sort of learned a lot. I look like I know what I'm doing as well in that video, don't I? Look quite professional.
What's the plan? What do you need?
We've got the biggest show we've ever done.
Yeah.
And we want to look good, don't we?
Yeah.
Cool, I like the idea of like a stripe on somewhere, either on the pants or
that would be cool,
on the arm. I like them quite high-waisted and tight around the top, and then the little flare at the bottom.
Joe's doing it.
What are you saying? Red suit, black stripe?
Yeah.
See, that's cool.
Come on, let's meet in the middle.
That's too fuck off. That is.
Come on.
Yeah. Your arms are 2 inches wide, do you know what I mean?
No, I've gone for like a wide 70s kind of lapel, sky blue, white shirt.
My suit's basically based on the old footballer Frank Worthington.
That's the vibe I'm going for.
Did you ever think he was going to make it big time?
Yeah, of course.
That's why you employed me.
Yeah.
But even though it was a good job and I loved it, it was still like the monotonous drives every day. I was driving, I was listening to radio, XFM at the time, and I remember they played, I think it was Cut Me, I'll Bleed, or I can't remember what tune it was, Blow and Rose or something like that, maybe even Blow. I was driving to work and I just went, I'm gonna quit. And I sort of drove into work. And he went, it's the band, innit? Like, you're doing really well. And he was dead, dead sound and was just like, yeah, I completely understand. So when you're leaving, I went, oh, no. He went, right now. And I remember just driving home, just turning the music up dead loud, just having all the windows down, driving home, like, yeah. Do you know what I mean? Like, I've done it. And then thinking, fuck, I still live at home. I've got to go to mum and dad now and say, I've quit my job. Do you know what I mean? Like, shit. I was like, it could all go tits up and I could be back here in like a few months going, can I have my job back, please? I'm sorry.
He knows the job's still open today. He's coming back one day.
So to go back there and actually work out.
Thank you very much.
See ya.
Bye.
Bye.
See
ya. Bye.
See ya.
So we're back. Tom and Miles got theirs on, looking good. Joe's the leather with flames. It's taking a bit longer because obviously it's leather with flames.
We wanted to like tie us in for summer. We didn't want to wear the same thing. Then I said, I wanted a stripe. Cool. And Joe was like, oh, we could all wear the stripes. So he nicked my idea, really.
Nice.
I let him off because it does look good.
Look at that, mate.
Really good.
Cool, that.
Christ, that's good. Wow.
Cool, isn't it?
Probably just a bit of ankle showing here.
You just want like a little bit of ankle.
Yeah, like that. Would that work?
So you're getting the pants taken in a bit?
Yeah, really good colours, them, Chaz. Proper your vibe, innit?
Ah,
hello there.
Right. Oh, that is fucking
tight.
Tight.
So whenever I've had anything made here, but particularly trousers, measure me up and they go, do you want pockets on the trousers or not? I'm like, well, why wouldn't you have pockets? Well, we don't normally if you don't need them or don't use them, but we're going to give you them because you don't have an arse. So now...
Oh, is that what's happened?
Now, they give him pockets, so his arse, so like it's more sticking
it's
out.
It's like, yeah, it's my equivalent of a padded bra.
That's what you're going to be drumming like.
So we released a new song the other day and it's called Your Girlfriend. This is it.
When a song comes together in the rehearsal room or a studio, you know, I've had an idea for a song and I take it to the lads and then we build on it and then it becomes the song. That's always great. When I was about 19, I thought, oh, I'm actually pretty good at this. But I never thought I would go on to do what we did.
Possible, she likes me too.
I was in my first relationship by that point, and I think that's when things changed, because I'd written songs in my old band up until that point, but I didn't really have anything to draw on it. Like, I wrote a song called Just 16, which was about the girls in our year at secondary school going out and drinking when they shouldn't be.
You got your fake ID now.
He gets in all the bars, but you forget that you're just 16 and you're gonna act like you're probably.
I didn't have a relationship till I was like 19, so that's when I obviously started writing about that, and then love songs come, and then heartbreak songs come, and then that my first breakup coincided with As Blossom Started, which I think ignited a whole turn of songwriting for me and the drive to want to do it. So things happen for reasons, don't they? I think that definitely did.
You might just have it on like the first one, but on the last hit of the chorus.
Put it on everyone just because I want to hear it.
There's loads of influences. It's a bit of everything. We've kind of like, it is very popular. Like the songwriting's kind of classic pop songwriting. And then you've got like Charlie's kind of like 70s groovy kind of Motown kind of vibey bass on it. And then you've got Josh's like harsh guitar parts that he puts on them. And then you've got like the, you know, the, everyone's got their own influences that they put together, which makes Blossoms.
When it's just a decay at the end of it, could you ride that up on something?
If you put the transient master on it and turn the decay up, that's what that will do.
It's hard to describe any band by just a few words in it, but yeah, I just say synth guitar pop. There we go.
Is that the right sound?
Obviously, I think the main thing is just releasing music which people like.
You can have just a normal shaker thing, you may as well do it. May as well do it, you know, on the profit, you know, with like the.
Oh, like we did on how long.
Yeah,
was
like. Thing.
But yeah. Like the horse riding one. That's fucking not that.
Yeah.
Because the groove's like natural within it, you can't really have that, can you? I don't even know what it needs to shake it.
When my dad first kind of showed me how to play the bass, I knew straight away, I was like, this is something I want to get into.
And she's a girl with more charm than most movie stars, so we met.
I never thought I'd do it to this level, but I knew I'd always be playing music, do you know what I mean?
Now your girlfriend is ringing in my ears again. It's no sure shot, but she likes all my favourite things. I know I shouldn't, but I'd like to spend more time with her. I wish she'd come over today.
So well, is it possible? She likes me too. I'm not sure if I should read between those lines. And now your girlfriend is ringing in my ears again. Should be moving out, but can't cause we've just signed a lease. My hands are shaking, the bedroom walls are paper thin. I heard her come over today. Thought maybe we go out for a just being friendly. And now your girlfriend is ringing in my ears again. And when she smiles, I can't hide my jealousy. Oh, I can't take it. Boy, I hope she's faking it. I heard he bought a ring today.
Thank you. It's our first ever single, it's called Blow.
I feel like we're in such an amazing position to say, to try and pick out what's the worst thing makes you seem like you're moaning, and I know there's a million other kids who would love to be in my position, so I don't think anyone really wants to hear it, if there is something, but you have good days and bad days, don't you? Like, there's pressure, but you try not to let it consume you. Because obviously I'm the songwriter, that's why I have to write the songs. Imagine I never wrote a song again. Like, what the fuck would we do? The worst thing about it is putting myself under pressure in my own brain. But I think it's good. It's a good enough amount to drive you.
When you're away from home for like a long period of time, that can be a bit shit sometimes. But just like missing your friends and your family and your girlfriend and kind of that kind of thing. But that comes with anything. That's just being away. Like, that's got nothing to do with being in the band.
I think it's broke.
I thought it was the other one that broke.
This is the other one. How long am I away for?
It's 9 days, isn't it?
Go.
Life on the bus, it's one of my favourite places to be, the tour bus.
You can take the party wherever you want.
There's something about it, like when you first get on there and you're like, you know, you get in bed. When you used to have sleepovers with your mate or like go camping, you kick your legs in the bed and you get dead excited. It's like that. It's like a big sleepover.
Try and eat without your hands.
And that's like the first night after 2 weeks with 16 lads on a tour bus, it's hanging.
Proper lad bus, innit? I think I walked out, it stunk of arse. It's horrible. Fucking, everyone's on the beers playing FIFA.
Yeah, fun fact for you.
Here we go.
Oldest logo in the world.
Stella.
When you've been on a bus for a few days and you've got to have a shower in a venue, it can get a bit annoying.
But you think it's mint backstage and the showers are class, not? Just a fiberglass box, innit?
All right, these showers, aren't they, Joe?
On the whole, it's, you know, it's fun.
Just wake up in the morning, have a coffee, then go and explore whichever city you're in, and then you're back to this home on wheels. It's a really special place, I think.
Joe always ribs me for speaking to the drivers and getting the numbers and texting them on a regular basis.
Why are you texting bus drivers?
You're a fucking normal guy.
I'm an old soul, and I just get up with everyone, I suppose.
Take care. Cheers. Have a nice night.
Have a nice night.
Have a great, wonderful day.
Where should we go?
Traveling is something that when I was growing up, I hated. I'm a proper home bird, but traveling with your mates in a band is the best thing ever.
Just traveling around and playing music that you've made and other people enjoying it in front of you. It's just all around good.
You know, it's like a school trip, but as an adult in a way.
We're hitting up Niagara Falls.
It's something you always dream of, you know, as a kid, to travel the world, tour the world as you know, for a living, you sometimes gotta pinch yourself.
That's one of like the fondest memories you have, being in a band, you know, being in a really unknown city where everything's different to like Stockport and being at home like Japan. We've been there a few times and that just springs to mind as like one of our favourite places. I'm usually the one finding restaurants on my phone, and any city we've played in, I've Googled best bolognese in.
There's something about it. Everywhere we go, it's like the only thing we can like all agree on.
Check this out for a review. The homemade tagliatelle with bolognese is great. Must be good then.
Very nice ragu. Yeah.
It's very strange, particularly when you come back from touring. Say if you've been away for like 2-3 weeks and then you come home back to Stockport, it's a really strange feeling coming back to normality. It's a weird one because you get knackered on tour, and then when you're off tour you're desperate to be back on tour, and not a lot of people understand that feeling, and they kind of like brush it off as something that's normal, but it's quite difficult to come back and adapt to normal life when you've been you know, in the middle of screaming fans looking at you. But I wouldn't change it for anything.
The song's called Blown Rose, everybody.
We take very seriously. There's a side to us which is like very bandy. Like we want this to be as like perfect as we can possibly make it at this time.
Are you going to be leaving the Strat song on a stand?
But then on the flip side, when we're not doing that, we're just being us.
I've started wearing nipple stickers, you know.
Nipple stickers.
We're always fucking poking out, aren't we?
I'd like to think that people perceive us as regular people because that's just what we are, you know. Just doing a bit of a strange job.
When you get picked up by a major record label, they try and morph you into someone that you're not. Whereas we've been quite fortunate and our label have kind of left us to our own devices. Yeah, we've kind of had a lot of creative freedom, which has helped us out massively and done us a lot of favours. That's really important, I think, in a band. For the people that matter, I think we're quite well respected.
Let's have a round of applause for Charlie Salt on the bass guitar.
We've always had big praise from like BBC, for example, ever since we were on the sound poll and things like that.
I know a few peers who spoke to us, like Noel or Paul Weller, Alex Turner. They've all said lovely things about us, which is mad, do you know what I mean? Because they're like huge idols in my eyes.
If they're into you, you're doing something right, aren't you?
I've seen Charlie Sheen, John Lennon's son's chilling over there.
And I get it. Yeah.
Stockport's finest, do we? Don't really fit in, do we?
Just weird, like when someone like Noel invites you on a tour, you can see him side today, he's watching you. You are just there thinking, this is mad, but then the other part of you is like, I want to work so hard because I want to get to that level.
Until you meet people and you spend a bit of time with them, they are just like figures that you see on stage. and you realise, oh, they're just regular people that eat soup or drink soup. Do you drink or eat soup? One of the two. But they're just regular people, you know.
It's just always appealed to kind of like a wide audience. We've always had the muse always at the back, and then like the young people like who go mental at the front from the beginning.
The younger fans are there because we're current.
Okay, I'll sit down again.
I think the older fans are there because
I think it's because the music is very cross-generational and it's not niche in a way. It's kind of just great melodies and honest classic pop songwriting.
Blossoms.
Blossoms.
Look it up. Enjoy. Double tap for the light.
Fans of them bands from the 60s and stuff will hear bits from there and they'll like it. Then these modern twists that kids will be into, but then these kids who are into all that old stuff as well. So I think the parents are into that music, then the kids become into that music, and then it just kind of lives on and keeps going.
His lyrics don't just appeal to 16-year-old girls or 40-odd-year-old men. They appeal to the masses. And it's everywhere she goes.
Sometimes we'll get recognised in the street, or you'll get people coming up for pictures and what have you.
She came up and she was shaking, this girl. She was like, I can't believe you're here in the Trafford Centre. I was like, why? Do you know what I mean? Just doing a bit of shopping.
Chisel from angels. Look at
awesome. Really? Can I see your thing? Can I see your boss? You know what? What if we come to Manchester?
How's the flight, Tom?
Do you know what? It was really good.
Oh,
I fell asleep.
Come here, look.
Why are you doing a live stream?
Say hi to my sister. She's called, yeah, sure. She's called Araminta.
What's her name?
Araminta.
Araminta?
Yeah.
Hello, Araminta. Nice to see you.
Could you possibly sign my chair? Thanks, Miles.
Konnichiwa. Watashi no Namae, Miles.
When we go to Japan, they print out masks with Miles' head on it and come to the gig like as Miles, which is endearing and also slightly terrifying.
I've been a fan and I've waited for a band behind like the kind of stage door, and I'm like, are they going to come out? Are they not?
Oh, George Donovan, where's George Donovan?
I absolutely love going out there and just being like, and just speaking to people. It just blows me head that, do you know what I mean? Someone would want me to go out there and say hiya to him or like sign something for him. And just, I don't know, it means a lot to me. Why fans probably like us, I would like to think it's because it's more, we are like a gang, and you can tell we're mates. Like when I see some bands, I can kind of see through it, and I think you're not actually mates. You don't really hang around with each other, whereas we do.
Like, we do have a laugh and we do have a drink and all that kind of stuff, but it's not like, you'll never see Josh throwing a fucking TV out of a window. That's just not what we are.
He's gonna go out and party now. Like always.
I don't fit into the rock and roll world. I'll do the gig, you know what I mean? I'll do the gig, then I'll watch Antiques Roadshow or something.
Sass? I found something interesting.
Okay.
And also, there's a nice...
How we are as people is literally just how we are as people. So, me talking in front of a camera or me at home looking at 70s pottery on eBay, it's the same person, you know what I mean?
It's not called Getaway, everyone.
For me, dead leaves upon the grass. I walk massive clean through 73. We broke like a paper sheet, but when it breaks, don't cry. I'll always hold some place for you and me.
I really don't think we would be where we are now and have done the things we've done if we weren't so tight and close. It just happens to be the rarest combination of five people that it just somehow works, you know.
I've known Tom all my life. He's like the nicest person I know. The most loyal, sort of caring guy I've ever met in my life.
He's always been like a big hero of mine, Tom, because he was always doing all the cool creative stuff in school. used to make films and stuff as well as the music side of things.
Tom's very, very honest. He wears his heart on his sleeve. It's a good trait, that. I like it.
Nice cash.
We are very much a democracy and we talk about stuff and we're all very honest with each other. There comes times when someone has to just take the lead.
First half of that was good on the last take.
And whether that comes from because I write the songs and it's naturally ingrained in that way over the years, sometimes it's needed to be like that. It's not like I rule and I say this, it's not like that at all. I'd say I'm the leader, but I'm not the loudest. The loudest, the most honest, is Joe.
You hear his laugh before you hear anything else.
Well, even if you're from Manchester, you gotta laugh sometimes, right?
I do not think Manchester people have a laugh.
Right, we're serious people, right?
Do you reckon?
You know, Joe's very intense and sort of business-driven, which works entirely in our favour. He just gets shit done.
Just put all my lot together.
He's probably the reason why we rehearsed so much in the early days and like that drive and stuff. So, which is good. It's kind of having someone who's a fan of the band in the band.
I think sometimes the lads get annoyed with me about it, but I sort of second or question everything.
Even if other people are thinking it, he'll be the one to say it.
Joe likes winding people up, doesn't he? Like, that's his thing. I think he gets bored, winds someone up, and then he laughs.
It's this, Miles. You can make your own maps, Super Mario Maker, but it's not fucking, it's not working.
You can make your own maps, Super Mario Maker.
You asked me, then.
Oh.
I replied, didn't I?
Even I know it's annoying, but I only do it with the best interest.
Almost like a family.
Like an interview or something like that, like Miles is the quietest.
I think I'm not a lot.
Yeah, we threatened to do it for a while, then.
But then, like, if we were in the studio, sort of recording a demo, Miles is like very upfront and very honest.
You got a transient designer plugin on that.
Miles is mint in like recording the stuff he adds and stuff. He's got a great ear for like complimenting Tom's songwriting.
I'll loop it to about 30. I think basically what it is knowing you are.
His brain works a little bit differently to everyone else's. He's just funny, got funny bones.
Yeah.
He can be odd, but in a lovable way.
But he's probably the most insane.
You got a moldy face.
I'm a bruised banana with a golden heart, golden locks, golden prints, man. I've got a $20 note with gold upon it.
Louis Theroux, it is mine! Go!
But then Josh has got his own quirks as well. Like, Josh is very alternative in a way.
Trees, plants, rocks and minerals.
He used to have pasta with salt for tea when he was a kid. It's like, he was
like, he doesn't need to speak to make you laugh. He's the unofficial Charlie Chaplin of Stockport. Really intelligent guy, great musician.
Josh is a gifted musician.
He seems to pick things up like straight away, or it seems like. I think that's what's really genius part of me. He'll always like compliment a tune.
I like to think I'm the glue that holds everyone together. Father figure of the band, hence my age. But Chaz is a proper, like, big brother kind of guy. He's kind of always had me under his wing. Good for morale. Love a night out. Shoulder to cry on.
he's a good-looking guy, isn't he? He's always got a big beaming smile on him. It's just, like, pleasure to be around, and just when he walks into a room, it's kind of like, you know, the mood lifts. He's always up for going out, seeing the city you're in. He's just always up for, you know, a laugh.
Always nice in April, isn't it, London?
The bad jokes, but the good jokes because they're bad.
Yeah.
We like them because of that.
Huh? It's lovely this time of year, Blackpool, isn't it?
You are a dad.
Probably the best bass player I've ever witnessed.
The only person on bass I reckon is better than him is the bass player from Chic. It's on par, though, it's on par, do you know what I mean?
You're a proper organ player if you can do that.
Well, we all just balance each other out, and it's just nature.
You know, you look through history, you see all these bands that are like kicking off with each other every 5 minutes. They never last, do they? I think we've got something quite special. We all get on, we've all got the same sense of humour, which is warped, but, you know, it works. You need the humour, you need like the camaraderie and stuff. Definitely works when you're on the road and you're spending sort of like 3 weeks with each other in each other's pocket.
I think with us, it's like the next extreme, because we sort of go on tours and we come back and we're in rehearsal room, but then even in our own time, we still see a lot of each other.
Squirt it in.
Spin it.
It's like a relationship, but it's between five dudes.
You what, mate?
What are we doing here?
Joe's dad's building a new fence for some reason, I don't know why.
I've never had a statecraft ever at home.
When there's a five of you.
It's not for me, that.
There's a lot of shit going on.
I played the first corner,
and
it was just all, like, out of tune.
Thank you very much.
Yay, but keys issues, so...
Yeah, I can't stop. We've just gone into a gig without anything being checked prior, and something's gone wrong.
Head to the B-rig.
And the B-rig wasn't set up.
There's always going to be arguments over something, whether it's what time we should be leaving to go somewhere, or whether it's this or whatever you're arguing about.
I completely disagree with you. So you don't know what you're talking about. We need a real tech, long story short.
If someone's annoyed about something or, you know, they'll just speak up and say it.
In the future, we need a production day to sort things out.
Listen. We have an argument, we have it out, and that's it. You find out your closest mates are the ones that you can just be completely honest with.
Exactly, it's fucking stupid.
When you're not friends, then that's when maybe things can get tricky.
I'd like to see you on everyone's shoulders if you can do it. Let's get everyone up. Now this is a song about heartbreak, Edgeley Park. And this song's called My Favourite Room.
Thank you very much, everyone.
I love just going the side of the stage and just watching it. My best mate is like singing to like 15,000 people, and he's got them in the palm of his hand. And it's just like the best feeling ever. Amazing.
This is the Mazda RX-7 1985, as featured in I Can't Stand It video and on the cover of the second record. So my granddad, in 1985, he imported it from Japan, and I've always been a fan of it. And when I came of age, I kind of got it out of the garage, cleaned it up a little bit, and I've had it since. So we're gonna pop up and see Granddad John. Like I say, you hear him before you see him in the ground. Charlie! Let's go and give him a knock.
Charlie, bring your master in here.
He's already giving it
is
that.
He?
We always like to think of him as like the unofficial mayor of Stockport.
How are you doing? How are you?
All right.
You smell nice. What have you got on?
Bit of Creed, you know.
He's kind of one of them characters you'd find in like a Dickens novel that just reoccur every now and again. The joke or two.
I'm here, lads. We've got you on here. I've got you on here. It's county.
Aside from everything he does for Stockport County, and he's done so much for us as a band, and he's our mascot, and we love him to bits.
When Blossoms did a gig, are we filming?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
When Blossoms did a gig.
You don't have to say it like that.
When Blossoms. It'll be edited out. When Blossoms did a gig at the Bungalow, which is next door to County, I organised it and I charged Conrad, the manager, 200 quid. And then I had to chase him for 3 years for the 200 quid. He never gave it me. So in the end, he's put that frame together and put the 200 quid in the bottom that he owes me with some nice writing. Like, if you count the 200 quid, there's only 180 there. He's done me out of 20 again, Conrad.
And I don't think he gets enough credit for what he's done for the band.
Do you want some more light in here?
I think you're one of the main catalysts for our success.
Do you think so?
100%, yeah. I think everyone in the band would say that as well.
Oh, that's very nice, that.
We rehearsed at the scaffolding yard and we had a room where we didn't have to pay. And it was like our hub. And to have that kind of base in the really early days, yeah, we're forever grateful.
Cheers.
We had some good times in that yard. It was only right to have it on the debut album cover.
I don't think you can ever have imagined early days that they would have achieved what they've achieved now. Well, it's been great for me to have the involvement with you, hasn't it?
Of course it has, yeah.
You know, I did the one where I'm running on at the start to announce the gig, didn't I?
You're playing here next year. There's a reason why.
What else have I done?
I reckon I could get a job at Christmas doing this.
Father Christmas,
phone.
Phone.
I think that's a brilliant video, that.
Nice thing is, wherever I go, specifically, like, you know, in and around Stockport, everyone always takes the time to ask how my granddad is. And of late, he's had a little bit of ill health. And as you get older, you start to appreciate, like, quality time with him more.
I hope we've done something right in the way we've brought all our children and grandchildren up, and we've always found that an important thing.
Young, you just take it for granted when you're young, but things change. You just, you appreciate who he is as a person a lot more, if you understand what I'm saying.
I've tried to lead my life through a film that I watched when I was a boy called It's a Wonderful Life. Very important the way you conduct your lives. You be kind and generous, and generous of heart. You don't have to be generous with money. You have to be generous of heart and generous of soul to everybody you meet and make them feel warm and wanted and that they're important.
It's not hard, is it?
No, it isn't. I'm getting upset now.
Great heart, great sense of humour. He'll do anything for you. I mean, he's more than a hero.
Everybody who asks me about Charlie, they always say, I bet you're dead proud of him, aren't you? And I always say, I'm more proud of the lad he's turned out than anything he's done with the band. That's more important. We're leaving here this is only the start of the journey. How far he's going to go, I mean, it's the moon and back, innit? So the moon and back.
Thanks, Brenda.
It's been so unfaithful. Let's have a round of applause for Joshua Dewhurst on the lead guitar, everyone.
I've always been surrounded by music growing up. A lot of parents would be quite cautious when their kid is like, you know, I'm going to quit everything and try and make it, so to speak. With my dad being a musician, it was always a sense that that was achievable.
Either. Not here, really.
Hey, up. How you doing, mate?
Good to
see you.
You
all right?
Good to see you.
We're so lucky to have his talents, and they've also worked in our favour as well. He's done a lot of arrangements for us, and he's come and played with us at gigs, and he's arranged some stuff for Edgeley Park as well, which is nice, because we thought we've got to have him involved on some level.
We thought it'd be special to do a midnight launch gig in our hometown Stockport, and we go on stage at the exact same time playing the album in track by track order, which I've not heard anyone else do before, so.
I mean, the idea of having a gig here was like a genius, because no one had done it before, had they?
Not on that scale. I think you got like Rod Stewart tribute, people like that, and.
And take that.
Take this. Yeah. I'm always extra anxious for any kind of hometown gig. You'll be there,
right.
And Mum will be there.
All right.
It just seems to have an extra thing.
Right.
It's not pressure, it's just it's more excitement, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's great, but equally terrifying. Hey. How you doing? You all right? It would be all right to have a little nosy round,
yeah,
for all time's sake.
Be our guest.
Thank you very much.
Problem.
Wonderful. First album, Midnight Show. We played when the album came out.
Yeah, I remember. It was amazing.
And we did it in its entirety. You said, we're going to play a new one for you now at the end, and just did Charlemagne again.
Oh, yeah.
Because everyone was already buzzing off that tune by then. Yeah. You know what I mean?
It was amazing.
Yeah.
And then playing the piano, yeah. And that organ.
And then the organ, yeah.
Absolutely insane.
The next time, we'll get you on that one.
Yay! Yay, good old lucky dad.
Doesn't Grandad have a chair here?
He has, yeah. I think
dedicated.
It's number 10, because he lived at number 10, didn't he? It was tactical with the 10 and then the, what was his road?
Melbourne,
10M. Yeah, that's it.
Oh, that's it?
Yeah.
In memory of Rodney Drummond Robertson. Our lovely dad and friend of the plaza.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's got a good seat, hasn't he?
Yeah,
look
well,
at that.
Yeah.
Prime view, really.
Yeah.
You can see everything. I hope someone gets me a chair here. It did feel quite theatrical down in the, you know, down in the dressing room. Like, we're going to come out and do, you know, he's behind you thing.
Yeah, it's turned into a pantomime.
Your pantomime style.
Yeah. Yeah, it was just a real unique thing, really. You kind of get the sense that Stockport's behind what we do.
Oh, definitely,
You know, kind of feel like people believe in us and whatnot.
Yeah, a lot of pride, isn't there?
People do buzz off the fact that we big it up so much.
You've always done that.
We've always said Blossoms from Stockport, not Blossoms from Manchester.
No.
Yeah.
We should be very proud of it.
Yeah, just
ambassadors.
Can't believe it.
Stockport.
Can't believe any of it, really.
Yeah. Insane.
Let's have a round of applause for Miles Keller from the keyboards, everybody. There's a reason why I... Thank you.
Come on, George. Watch the shit. All right, you're getting off now, come on.
Everyone knows who we are now. So people always want to talk to you about it. And
I'm a dead anti-social dog walker, mate. I'll like go the other way if I see people coming and stuff like that.
Go on. I'll say hello and stuff, but I'm not like, don't go out my way to be like, how's your day been and stuff like that. It's just not me. But then when I'm on stage and doing stuff, then that's when I can kind of come out my shell a bit more. But then that's more like an act, isn't it? It's not really what I'm like day to day, to be honest.
George,
when you're on stage, you can't see the whites in people's eyes, you know. I'm addressing like 15,000 people, aren't I? Like, if I had to address one person who I've never met on a dog walk, it's like, that's more, like, that fills me with more fear, which sounds mad, but it does.
What do you want?
We're all still living, stop, but there's a normality to it, like, doing stuff like this when you are home every day, it kind of just feels, you know, it's a million miles away from like Edgeley Park, innit, or the Pyramid Stage at Glastonbury or whatever. In the past, I've like worked myself up, say, you know, like in between albums and have, say, been on the road for a while and you come home. And I used to struggle a bit with switching off, but I just, you know, you find other things that you know, like cooking, just dead normal things, walking the dog and,
good boy,
say, I've been in the house trying, like, you know, writing tunes. And then, you know, I can come away for half an hour, come in here and walk George, and then I'll be over there and then just a tune will pop into my head. Then I'll sing it into my phone, then go back and then I'm away again. But the fact we are here and you can go and see your family and you can go and do other things, I think it's just being able to walk away from it if you need to.
The last time I asked you,
The gig will always stay with us because it was the first of its kind. And it was like the first time we'd played a stadium. And I probably built it up to be something in my head too much, you know, because I wanted everything to be perfect. You know, I wanted where the parents were sat to be perfect. So I was worrying about that. I was like, you know, and you can't take on all that. You need to just step back and be like, just play the gig, enjoy it. Like, we didn't want to stay in Stockport before the gig, you know, because we just like, you're just too close to it all. So we went away and like, you know, went in a spa and stuff and sat in a jacuzzi. And then, you know, we drove back in. And you know, just the scene, the streets swarmed with people. Being like, you know, like a festival on the streets of Stockport. And we drove in, everyone was like, you know, we had to shut the road to get the car in.
Closed the whole road.
We did joke about it in the early days. We did say, oh, imagine playing there, Blink 5 years later, and it's a reality. Because we're still in the car, like, us five as mates from school, and, you know, we're like, this is mad. Because you've grown up there, you go past it on the train every time you go to Manchester. You used to go and watch football games there, like, it's literally like the stuff of dreams, isn't it? You could write it in a book that you read at school about starting a band, and then where they end up in the final scene would be there. Testament to, you know, the music and what we've created, and that we weren't mad from the start.
One of the first ever gigs was at the Bungalow, little place just behind the stage there. 30, 40 people after a game on a Saturday.
Yeah, totally.
And look where they are now.
Now, how do we top that?
When the sun started to go down and it was darker, and you could feel everyone was having a great time.
The bar's there now. You've got to get to, like, there.
I didn't want it to end.
Now, as you can imagine, this is quite surreal for us five, because we grew up just over there. Some of us from Offerton. Some of us from Woodsmoor. And some more from Offerton. And you've truly made our fucking life tonight, everyone, so...
I wrote that song in the back room.
I want to know if you've got room for one more song.
You know, we've got a record deal off that.
I said, have you got room for one more song, Stockport?
To then play it in front of all them people. And they're the moments that you're living for. And you know the crowd are just going to go fucking mad.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Cheers, mate. Nice.
So good.
Unreal.
Put that on it. Cheers.
Tom, see the guy and then pull the lemon. It's got to my head already. Jody!
Hey. You want the kettle?